Covenant Kingdom series that we've been in. This is our fifth week, and just a real quick review in case you haven't been here. Covenant is about God our Father, that God is our Father, and He gives us His identity, and He's cut a covenant with us. And then the other part of that is that God is also a King, and Kingdom is about doing things. Covenant is about being. Covenant is about our identity. Kingdom is about how that lives out in everyday life. And today we're going to be talking about substitution and victory. And these two are really important terms because the cross of Jesus Christ, the substitution, the cross is about the substitutionary death and the victory of God over all of our enemies. It's just, this is the core message. You know, substitution is about covenant and how we have seen this in our trip through the Bible in so many different places. Just quickly, the Garden of Eden, remember, where they were made in God's image, and there was no separation between the man and the woman and God, and then they sinned, and they tried to cover themselves with the fig leaves, and what does God do? But God sacrifices an animal, an animal substituted to try to cover their sin. And then we had the story of Abraham and how Abraham waited, you know, 25 years for God's covenant promise, so the promise of a son. And then once the promise came, and of course, you know, everything that God has was Abraham's, but likewise, everything that Abraham had was God's. And so God, that very difficult passage where God calls him to go to Mount Moriah and there to sacrifice his only son, Isaac. And there in that picture we saw as Isaac is, you know, bound and on the wood on the altar, and God says, stop, and there's a ram that's caught in the thicket. There's a substitution. God provides the substitution. Or the story of Moses at Passover, where, you know, a lamb for each family was sacrificed and the blood was put on the doorposts, and death didn't come to that family. There was a substitute, and it was in that Passover lamb. And this is just a recurring theme as we go through the Bible of a substitution. And there's so many more, but they all foreshadow the cross. Every one of them points to the cross, which is God's original plan of salvation from the very beginning. And in Ephesians 1, it says that we were predestined to be in Christ. That from the very foundation of the world, you know, this was the plan, that God had predestined the cross and predestined Christ. So it's just a huge topic. And I think we're all familiar with what substitution is because we know it in life. We live, we substitute, we give ourselves for somebody else all the time. And, you know, if we see this in our human relationships, and it's neat, we've got a couple that's having their second child today, because, you know, when you have your first child, it's just such a surprise. You know, we wanted to have a baby, and now we've got this baby, and, you know, we have all these images of what this is going to be like, and you go out and you buy all the stuff, right? And you make the house perfect and the room perfect. You got to repaint everything. And you buy, you know, you go to the stores. They got these giant box stores that have everything imaginable that you could have for a child. And you have to have it all, you know. And you get it all home and everything's just going to be wonderful. And it is until the baby comes. And then, you know, God kind of tricks you because He gives you a human baby. And since it's a human baby, the human baby has his or her mind of his own, and he doesn't sleep when you want to sleep. And, you know, he wants to eat when he wants to eat, not when you tell him to eat, and all that kind of stuff. And usually after about 5 months, 6 months, when you finally get like 5 continuous hours of sleep for the first time, and you wake up and you go, now you've got your right mind, and you say, I think one's enough. You know, one child is probably enough because this child is perfect, and how could we do any better than this child is the excuse that you give. But really, there's this exchange, this taking that this child takes things from you. He takes your time and he takes your energy and he takes your waistline and, you know, all that other kind of stuff. He takes or she takes away from you, and you substitute. You give things to this baby that you never thought that you would have to give. You know, it's a total surprise. But that's the way things are with our relationships. So whether it's a child or whether it's just a friendship, it's going to cost you something. You're going to have to give something to this. You're going to have to give some of yourself into this relationship, right? Last year, a guy named Dwayne and his wife, Donna, Buena Vista, Colorado. They had the perfect day planned. You might have seen this in the news. It's a terrible thing. He was an electrician, high school football coach, and he took his wife and his two daughters on a very popular trail that they go on all the time. But an unthinkable thing happened. There was a rock slide. And just before these rocks came down and swept Dwayne and his wife and his oldest daughter to their deaths, okay, Dwayne made a decision that saved his younger daughter, his 13-year-old daughter's life. A few weeks after the tragedy, Gracie, his daughter, she said, "I did cover myself, but I was just standing in the open, and Dad pushed me to a rock that was bigger than I was, and he saved me." And the sheriff's deputy said that Gracie had said that her dad jumped on top of her to protect her at the last moment when the rocks were coming down. And so immediately after the rock slide, the rescue workers were there and they saw a hand sticking out from underneath the rocks. And it was Gracie. And they got the rocks off of her. And yes, her father had saved her life. And she alone lived to tell the story. And as the news was going around the local town and the school and everybody that knew Dwayne, they said, well, he really wasn't the hero type. He would do this for anybody. It didn't make any difference if it was his kids or somebody else's kids, no matter who it was. He was the kind of guy that would always put himself between danger and someone else. I mean, we see these stories all the time of these people that, you know, the news says, oh, they're great heroes, and yet they're just really doing what we do, right? You see somebody that needs some help. You see somebody that's in danger, and you substitute yourself. You put yourself in the way. He was really being a father or a parent or a friend or a grandparent or an aunt or an uncle. That's who he was. He was just a person. We know what it is to substitute. In Christ, there is a new covenant. The old covenant, the Old Testament — testament means covenant — the Old Testament, the New Testament, testament here means covenant. Substitution is the core truth that runs through the New Testament. Jesus cut a new covenant with us. That was why he came. He didn't come just to teach us nice things or to teach us how to live with each other, but the reason that he came was to cut this covenant. This was the main purpose of why he came, and he came to make this new covenant because the old covenant was incomplete, and the old covenant had some flaws. So we hear him on the night when he was betrayed saying something that was almost unbelievable. We don't really think about this much, but to Jewish ears, this is an unbelievable thing what Jesus said. Luke 22, verse 20. And they're in the upper room. And he said, "And likewise, this cup, after they had eaten, saying, 'This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant, my blood.'" We usually say words like that, the words of institution, as we take communion. So what's unbelievable about that is he's saying, "Here's a new covenant in my blood." Now, they just didn't throw the word covenant around. So for Jesus to say this, he really is encapsulating his whole mission in life. Covenant, to make two parties into one. This is about being one with Jesus. If we are one with Jesus, then as we've gone through, everything that he is and everything that he has is ours. And everything that we are is his as well. And that's what happens in a covenant. The two are made into one. They both die. They're both born into a single person. Just like marriage, right? It's no more mine and yours, but it's ours, right? That's the whole idea. And that's what Jesus was saying that night in the upper room. He said, "When you drink this cup of the new covenant," now remember this, because we're going to get to this later, right? "When you drink this cup of the new covenant that's been made in my blood, we're one, you and me," he's saying to us. Even to us today, 2,000 years later, that's what he's saying. He said, you and I are one when you drink this cup. Isn't that great? Now, Paul explains this also well for us, and this is where we're going to spend our time today, is in 2 Corinthians 5, beginning with the 14th verse. We'll spend our time here because he explains exactly what all this means. So I'm just going to read this in pieces and kind of comment on it as we go through. It's a huge section of Scripture, I mean, his importance. 2 Corinthians 5, beginning with verse 14. He says, for the love of Christ controls us because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. See? One had died, and therefore all have died. That's what he says. We're in him. We cannot be in the new covenant and be in our old life at the same time. They're incompatible. Can't have both things. See? We've died. And then he gives us this logical progression. He says, and since, you know, the result of this death is that we might no longer live for ourselves, but for him. We're now in him, one in him. Someone's giving you their life, then the natural progression of that is that you would live for them, right? Might have some of you read Ragamuffin Gospel, really popular book. A guy named Brennan Manning wrote it, author, speaker. Amazing story of how he got the name Brennan. While he was growing up, his best friend was a guy named Ray, and the two of them did everything together. I mean, they ran together when they were teenagers. They bought their first car together. They went on double dates together. Everything they did together. They enlisted in the army together. They went to basic training together. They even ended up in the same platoon, same squad. They were inseparable friends. And, you know, as he tells the story, one night they're at war. They're sitting in the foxhole. And Brennan is reminiscing about the old days in Brooklyn and, you know, everything they'd gone to together. Here they are a long ways away from home and in danger. And Ray just listened and was sitting there eating the chocolate bar. And suddenly a live grenade falls into their foxhole. And Ray just looks at Brennan and smiled, dropped his chocolate bar, and dropped on the grenade. The grenade went off. Killed him right there, but Brennan survived. So years later, after the war's over and they come back home, and Brennan becomes a priest, a Catholic priest. And he's asked to, as is the practice, to take a new name to mark this change in their life. And so he took the name Brennan as his name. And years later, he goes to visit Ray's mom. And late one night, they're sitting there drinking tea and talking about Ray and what a great guy he was. And Brennan says, do you think that Ray loved me? And Ray's mom gets out of her chair and goes over in front of him. And she gets her finger out and points it right in his face. And she says, what more could he have done for you? And Brennan says at this time that he has this epiphany, he has this understanding. And he says at that moment, he sees himself standing at the foot of the cross. And here's Jesus on the cross, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, is at the cross too, and she's got her finger out, and she's pointing in Ray's face, or in Brennan's face, and saying, what more could he have done for you? You say, when we stand before God, we say, did he really love me? Does God really love me? You know? And that's the story of how he got his name. When we realize that he died for us, we want to live for him. It's life-changing. This is the core of what it means to be converted. It's to understand that God has given everything that he has for us, and it changes us forever. Now let's go on. 16:17 here. It says, from now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. behold, the new has come. It's good scripture. You're a new creation, you know. Well, we hear that, and we might think, well, if we're really honest with ourselves, well, yeah, I know I'm a new creation, but the old is just wearing kind of heavy on me, man. You know, because it's like, you know, if I'm a new creation, then why do I do some of the same things that I've always done? It doesn't feel real new. I know it says that I'm new, but gee, the reality of this, I think this is what he's saying here. He's saying the new has come, but it's kind of like the birds that sing before the sun comes up. That'll happen again. All right? We're just a month away. The birds will return, and you'll be sitting in bed about 5:30, and the birds will start singing before the sun comes up, right? Now, what... They sing because they know that the sun is always going to come up, right? They're anticipating the light. And that's what it is for us being a new creation, is that God has deemed us to be a new creation, and we're kind of like the birds that are hoping to sing before the sun comes up, because we know it's going to happen someday, because it's in God's hands. It's not in our hands whether we act like a new creation or not. The fact that we are a new creation is all about Him. So, you know, in between times, we're waiting for the sun. We long for holiness. We long for perfection. We long to have this world put right where, you know, good people don't suffer and no one suffers. We long for that day, but we're kind of like the birds. You know, it's going to happen. We're in the process of being made a new creation. And that day is going to come. Nothing can happen in your life that can take that away from you. Nothing can happen in your life that can take that away from you. You cannot do anything to make His death unhappen. Okay? It's fact. You can't undeath Christ. You can't uncross what has happened to you. It's done. It's over. There are some things that surprise our knowledge and are way beyond our ability to understand. But this, my friends, is not in our realm of where our belief can stop it. It has been done. Verse 18. He says, all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to Himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That's a big word. First notice that Christ reconciled us to Himself. We don't reconcile ourselves to God. Reconcile means to merge or to put right. And I always remember this one by thinking of, in your word processing program up there, you'll have the choice, you know, straight on the left, straight on the right, in the middle, or reconcile, as where both margins look nice. You know, if you want to really dress up something, you do reconcile, and your margins are nice on the sides. And that's what Christ does for us. He reconciles us. He takes our crooked places, and He makes them straight, see, for Himself. Our lives are all jagged and out of line, but God reconciled us to Himself. And He didn't say, well, now you just go get yourself all right, then you come back to me, and then maybe we can have something, you know. It says He reconciles us. So we may look at ourselves and think, I'm all still jagged and I'm all out of place, but when God looks at us, He sees us reconciled, unless we're going to call Him a liar, you see. Because that's what He sees in us, is that we are just the way He wants us to be. Because when He sees us, He sees Jesus Christ. It's hard. I know this is hard to take in. It's called substitution. And look, it says that since God has reconciled us to Himself, this new covenant that Christ made, we have the same ministry. Now, that only makes sense, right? Since we're one in Him, since our identity's in Him, since we have been... we have died and we have been now born in Him, then what He does is what we do. We have the same job. Now, this part of it is about kingdom. The world was lost, you know, because of humans. And then God reconciles the world to Himself through humans, the same ones who made a mess of things. And we have this ministry of reconciliation. God works through His kingdom agents, who's who you are, to reconcile this world to Him. He sends us out as reps, the King does. So often we look at this world and we go, I don't know. You know, you hear this question all the time. Well, why doesn't God do something? Why doesn't God do something about what's going on in this world? I mean, we look at what, you know, the suffering in Ukraine, or you can just pick a whole lot of different places and go, why isn't God doing something? And God says, I am. You're it. I am doing something. My people, my kingdom agents, you're the ones that are doing something about it. See, we want to leave it all with Him. He says, I've started this kingdom. I've chosen you. You're in me. I've given you my authority. You are my kingdom agents. You are the reconcilers. Go out and do it. Now, verse 19 says, that is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to Himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us this message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors. We're going deeper. We are ambassadors for Christ, God making His appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. This action, this doing of the kingdom arises, of course, from the covenant. God made us one with Him. We have died with Christ. We are now sons and daughters. God has reconciled us to Himself. So then He appoints us as ambassadors of the kingdom of God. We have been given the authority of the King. You know, when an ambassador is in the consulate or the embassy of a foreign nation and somebody does something to that ambassador, it's just like you did it to the whole nation, right? You are there in the authority of the nation. And that's what the way this ambassador is used. We have been sent out as reconcilers in this world, and we represent the King. So you get the idea. You know the reality, you know, of that we have His authority, we have His power. If anyone attacks us, they attack Him. It's just like God said to Abraham, I'll bless who you bless, I'll curse who you curse. That's the new covenant. So, just let me review this for us just real quickly here. Number one, you're a dead person. You've died. You've died in Christ. Number two, you've been born again. You are a new creation. It is happening right now in you. You may not see it completed today, but it is happening. Number three, you didn't have a chance. You were lost. You did none of this yourself. God has done it all for you. God has reconciled what was wrong in you. And number four, you're sent. You've been given His authority, and in His name, you're sent into a foreign land as His ambassador. So when we say, I'm a Christian, that's what we're saying. That's what this means. When we say, I'm a Christian, all this stuff, it means I'm dead. I've been born in Him. I got the authority of the King. We say, I'm a Christian, and it means, well, I like Christian music, or I go to that church. No, this is what we're saying when we're saying, I'm a Christian, I'm a little Christ. It's all these things are wrapped up in that. We walk around saying, I'm a Christian all the time. We're saying a whole lot more than what we know. There's more to come. Verse 21, it says, for our sake He made Him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. God made Him sin. We say that so easily, don't we? Well, let me unpack this just a little bit. God made Jesus a liar. God made Him just an angry, vengeful man. He says He made Him sin. God made Him greedy. God made Him unfaithful. God made Him a person who uses and manipulate people. That's who God made Jesus. God made Him a racist. God made Him anxious. God made Him afraid. God made Him a man who's addicted to porn. I could go on worse here, right? That's who God made Jesus when He made Him sin. All of those things and everything, the worst of us. There's nothing that you have done that He has not been made. He covers our room. See, you can't out-sin this. Everything, He made Him that. God made Him sin. Since Jesus had no sin, God infected Him with this disease of sin, and the disease killed Him. is what happened. He gave him the disease so that you can have the antibody, his blood. He became sin, and we became sons and daughters. So when he looks at you, he genuinely sees Jesus, because you are one with him, remember? Your life is in him, and he did it all. So he became our substitute. He became our Passover lamb. He became our ram caught in the thicket. He takes the consequences of our sin. He shields us from the rock slide as it's coming down the hill. He's our substitution. And the cross stands, if we can think of it this way, as the outreach arms of Jesus that says, all can come. No one's too sinful to come to me. And then the vertical beam is that connection between heaven and earth where God says, my kingdom is coming. My kingdom is coming, and you are the ambassadors. You're the ones that I've sent. I've empowered you. I've given you my authority. Most of the time we focus on the forgiveness that comes from the cross. But there's a victory that's in the cross too, you see. And I want to just touch on that briefly here at the end. Matthew 27, 51 to 54 is Matthew's account at what happened that day at Calvary, beginning with verse 51. As Jesus is on the cross and he dies. And then we get to verse 51. And he says, and behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the temple is in the Holy of Holies where the Ark of the Covenant was. And it's torn from top to bottom. And the earth shook. The rocks were split. The tombs were opened. Many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. And when the centurion and those who were with him kept keeping watch over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, truly this was the Son of God. Covenant statement. See, already in that day there's been darkness beginning, you know. Darkness covers the land, and then there's earthquakes. And now the tombs are opened. Okay, and people are crying. They're scared to death. They think this is the terrible day of the Lord that John the Baptist warned us about was coming. And it is. It's the judgment of God upon the earth. But the judgment falls on Jesus. The judgment doesn't fall on the earth. The judgment, the king on the cross is the one that's judged that day. The kingdom comes. God declares his judgment. He declares it on Jesus. And that means that all of those who are in covenant with Jesus, you've already had your day of judgment. You had it that day with Jesus. Understand? You've been judged. Your sin's been judged once. It won't be judged again. The earth is shaken. The darkness has come and the tombs have been opened. And then just one more passage here. Colossians 2, 13 to 15. Paul says, and you who were dead in your trespasses, and oh, we were, and the uncircumcision of your flesh, that means we were our flesh, we were not in the covenant, the uncircumcision, remember, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us. Okay, you think you got a permanent record of everything bad that you've done? No, it's been nailed to the cross, it says. With all of its legal demands, this he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and the authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. This is the victory of the cross that's been won for us. The king has come. He's fought the battle. Jesus is our substitute and our champion. And when he dies, he takes on all the enemies that we cannot defeat. That's the victory. We can't defeat sin. It's too big for us. He did. We can't defeat the law. It breaks us. He defeated the law. We can't defeat death. Jesus did. We can't defeat the devil. He lies. His constant accusations against us. Jesus did. It says he disarmed the rulers and the authorities. He took their weapons away from them. I like to always think about this in the sense that the weapons he took away was like he took away that 9mm and gave him just a starting gun for a race. Because he still makes a lot of noise. It's still a lot of noise to us, but there's no danger in it whatsoever. So the enemy still continues to accuse us and to lie to us and tell us all kinds of stupid things, but it's just a bunch of noise. He can't defeat us. James 4, 7 to 8 says, submit yourselves to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. See, Satan throws these darts at us, these fiery darts, these little weapons, and he says things like, God's against you. That's why things are going so bad in life. It's because God's really against you. I mean, how can he be for you when all these things, these bad things are happening to you? Another fiery dart, he says, I have accusations that I'm going to bring against you because of your sins. He says, what can you say in your defense? You've got no defense. You knew you were doing wrong and you did it anyway. Those are the kind of fiery darts that he throws at us. He can say, you say that you're forgiven, but there's a payback day coming. You know, you think you can just go, oh, I'm sorry, and that's it. No, that's another fiery dart, another lie he gives us. He says, how are you going to defend yourself on that day? The last one I think of, he says, given your track record, what hope is there that you will persevere to the end? Oh, you get up and you get down, you get up and you get down. He says, you're not going to make it. Now you're going to give up the faith. Those are just some of the lies that he throws our way. And James, brother of Jesus, says, submit yourselves to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. It's just a lie. He's been defeated, it says. He's been defeated at the cross. All the powers, the principalities, the very rulers of darkness were defeated back then. That's covenant and kingdom. So, your identity, you're a son or you're a daughter of Christ. Remember that today. You are hidden in Christ. You have died in him. Your authority, evil has no authority over you. See, you're a representative of the king. The king has authority. All those fiery darts, all those things that we hear in our head, resist the devil, he'll flee. Just don't listen to him anymore. Okay, they don't stop coming. You know, he's relentless in his attack. Just don't listen to it. Substitution. God has done for us what we cannot do for ourselves. And he wants us to walk in him. And that's what it means to be a Christian, is to walk in this. It's good stuff. Let's sit just for a moment in prayer for this. God of heaven, come down just to know that you are near is enough. God of heaven, come down all things.
And all who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain, dip your heart in the stream of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy. As deep cries out.